I was nailing the last piece of wood on the roof, so I put the nailing gun down on the tile roof, held the piece of wood in place, and the nail gun slid down the tiles, and it pushed against my knee. As I reached down to grab the gun, I grabbed the trigger. It shot a spike right through my kneecap. So I'm up on the roof, and of course my knee is nailed shut because, you know, I can't straighten my leg because the nail went right through the kneecap, came out the other side. So I had to get my buddy to go down and get a pair of pliers to pull the nail out. And when he came up the ladder and we pulled the nail out, I stood up and grabbed the piece of wood and grabbed the nailing gun and nailed it, finished the job I was doing.
You know, it makes no sense, really. We hire a professional thinking they're some sort of demigod. And in fact, in some ways, they are a lot like us. Learning on the job. Making mistakes.
I fell off a roof a while back. 22 feet. But I went back to work.
This is Chris. He's a contractor in Vancouver. He spoke with Ann Pepper the other day.
And what about wearing safety glasses? You'd rather not, or they get in the way?
I live on the edge. I live right at the edge.
Do you think you have more accidents than other people?
No, but when I have one, I have a good one.
And here's the thing about Chris. He admits he doesn't return calls very reliably. He's a bit clumsy. And yet, he is always busy. They all are. Contractors these days. And it's all because of people like you and me, friend. Watching these home renovation shows on TV and getting a false sense of bravado. Do you know this feeling? You got a bit of spare time on your hands. You're at home. You're staring at the wall. And suddenly a voice in your head says, you could totally take that wall down. And then you end up here.
I'm Mike Brown, and I work in the flooring department. Customers coming in, all of a sudden, I have no power. And it's everybody around me does, so it's something in the breaker panel. They'll come in and talk to one of the electricians. And...
But wouldn't they, like, call their electrical utility?
No, a lot of people like to do it themselves. I had a customer come in. They had bought a one-piece tub that they were trying to install themselves. And they had drilled the holes completely in the wrong places for the faucets. So they were panicking because basically they have this $1,000 tub that now all of a sudden the holes are about 2 feet too high.
Of course we do this to ourselves. What causes this behavior?
Trading Spaces goes home on the range as Genevieve rolls into action.
This is Trading Spaces. It's one of those home renovation programs that's become the cultural cocaine for suburban television addicts. In the case of this show, two neighbors swap homes for a weekend, and with the help of two designers and a carpenter that's supplied by the show, they redecorate a room in each other's home. And so, like little kids making our first easy-bake cake, we watch the shows. We try to replicate exactly what they do on screen. And end up screwing it up. Well, this morning on the Real Life Chronicles, we explore this new cult of home improvement television. We take you to the set of the Canadian version of this show. Also, after the trucks leave, Don Brett sweeps up the gossip after the TV crew pulls away. And boys with toys. Fellow men, listen up. Power tools do not make us sexy. I know. I thought they did too. Stay with us. First, bad blood. When we started researching this show, we talked to the people at the Decorating Challenge, which is the Canadian version of Trading Spaces, as it were, and completely unrequested, we got this email from them. It is a list of reasons. It's essentially a top 10 list of reasons why their show is different than Trading Spaces. And little picky things like the Canadian show participants don't have to have homework at night, but the American people do, and their designers get to go to the hotel. And they get $1,000 to work with, while we give our people $1,500 to work with. It's the most bizarre list of rationalizations, essentially. It is a defense. And we wanted to know, why be defensive? Vivian Campbell is the executive producer of The Decorating Challenge.
In 1997, I think it was September 1997, we had this idea for this crazy decorating show, and we did a pilot to see if it was going to work, whether or not the concept would work. We did not know about any other show that was out there when we did this one. It was purely, you know, pure coincidence that there was something even in the UK that was similar. And we had a phone call after we'd been on the air, I guess, about 6 months from the Discovery Network in the US saying they had seen our show, they liked it, and would we be interested in selling it to them? And we were talking to them over a few months, and then suddenly they said, well, actually, we're looking for an hour's show, and we've decided we're going to do our own show. And we were a little disappointed because we saw lots of our show in their show, even though they said they based their show on changing rooms. But one of the names that we had on the list was Trading Spaces. And we never thought we would get, you know, the okay to use that name because of the movie called Trading Places. One of the young women who works on our show happened to be down in, I think it was Los Angeles, at the same time Trading Spaces was there, and did meet someone from that show. I think it was the producer, and she said, I work on Decorating Challenge in Toronto. And the producer sort of just looked at her and sort of walked away. I drive a van that says Decorating Challenge on it. And so I drive it all the time. And even just going to the supermarket, I come out and there's, you know, little pieces of paper with big sort of lips kissed onto them, stuck on my windshield saying, please, please come and do my house. And then they start getting out, you know, a pad and paper. They draw out their room that they want made over. And how do I see it looking? One of the most disappointing shows for us was a show actually that aired this season, and the designer had gone to see the lady, and the lady had said that she was from Nova Scotia, her and her husband. They were very homesick, and that their style was, well, have a look at my artwork on my walls. That'll tell you what my, you know, what my color range is and what my love is. So the designer looked at the, you know, pictures on the walls, and they were fishing scapes from Nova Scotia. So the designer went away saying, I know, I'm going to give her a Newfoundland kitchen. And she put lighthouses and lobster traps and netting on the walls, and she put shingles on her counter, you know, down the sides of her middle counter. And the woman hated it. The woman totally hated it. And she stood there absolutely dumbfounded and was incredibly upset. And in fact, I understand she started a website saying what we did to her kitchen. We crucified it. And I tell them up front, if you're that concerned about what we're going to do, do me a favor, don't do the show. Because we will do what we want to do. The designer has carte blanche. So if you're concerned, just don't do the show. And we're very upfront with them, and they sign a release to that effect. You interview participants and you think that you've done a really thorough job interviewing them. And then you get to, you know, the front door on the first morning, and they open it and they're wearing gloves and masks. And you say to them, what's with the gloves and the masks? And they say, oh, didn't we tell you? We're allergic to paint and dust. And these two participants sat in their back garden for the 2 days that they were doing the show, reading their magazines in the sunshine and coming in to dab a little bit of color on the wall so we could get them on camera. And we had to use our crew to actually do the makeover. So we've been bitten a few times. We're going to the Vancouver home show. I understand Trading Spaces is going to be there. Two of their designers are also going to be there. So we're ready to kick some butt.
Vivian Campbell is the executive producer of The Decorating Challenge. You can catch an episode today at 4 Eastern, 1 Pacific on the W Network.
I'm Denis Grignon in Pickering.
Like all in between? Okay. Why don't we get Christy painting the flowers?
It's 9 o'clock Sunday morning in Pickering, a bedroom community east of Toronto. Two TV crews have arrived at the neighboring homes of Chrissy Dino Brega and Christine Osborne. By crew, I mean a few dozen cars, trucks, and vans. They're all taking over the usually serene street. This is the second day of shooting. The remodeling is starting to take shape. Inside the homes, mayhem, stress, and panic have taken over. As with most shoots, they're behind schedule. And here's something you won't see on TV. It's not just the homeowners and their respective teams of tradespeople working. Everyone on the crew with a free hand has jumped in. The producers are stenciling, the makeup person is sewing, Attila the sound guy is filling up a lava lamp with water. René Montpellier, the host, doesn't saunter off to a trailer between takes. Instead, she's vacuuming the stairs.
I don't know how to turn it off. All evidence of decorating challenge is soon disappearing.
It's a scene you won't see in the show.
Boy, no prima donnas here.
This is not a glamorous job. Whoever said it was...
In fact, the crew does 80% of the work.
Oh, it's about chipping in and being part of the team.
Renee's a trooper.
And in a way, that's what makes this show so uniquely Canadian. Not only does everyone on set pitch in, everyone is polite. Painfully polite. Like when Ellie the designer transforms a fireplace into a daring but questionable mix of Gilligan's Island meets Battlestar Galactica. Even the show's producer, Anne, is hesitant to deride it.
Silver bamboo kind of jumps out at you, eh?
It certainly does, doesn't it?
How do you feel about it?
What does it look like? I think it looks
it's a mood not lost on Chrissy, one of the homeowners.
I'm right, an American. Are Americans rude? Aren't they classified as rude? I think I would tell the truth. I don't think I would try to hide it. At least I hope not. If I didn't like it, I would probably say it's going to have to grow on me a little bit or something like that. I don't know if I'd come right out and say this is awful. I don't know. I wouldn't want to offend the decorator.
After all, the whole secret truth behind this show is how you stretch the truth.
And let's do once more.
The same thing what you just did, or just keep stamping?
Just pretend?
Yeah. Really, the stuff that gets on the air, it's more like we're staging some of the stuff, you know? Uh-huh.
But this is Derek. He's a camera operator on the set.
And you have to build that sequence out of, like having the person do the same things over and over again, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, everybody wants to look good on camera, especially if this is the only performance on camera, because once that big black eye is in your face, you know, it's not that comfortable. It's like acting 101, you know?
If this is acting, then the real screen test for these homeowners comes now.
This lady is way too far back.
Christy?
Yeah,
bring her
okay, forward. Everybody, you know the rule? Everybody's quiet.
It's 9 p.m., well past the hoped-for end of the shoot. The crew is setting up for the final shot, what the producers call the reveal, when the homeowners finally see what their friends have done to their room.
Okay, are we speeding?
We are speeding.
Oh, man, that's
okay,
just a
so hang on, girls.
And this, perhaps more than any other time, is a true Canadian's test of their spirit. To appear to be happy for
all
your
right.
friend's feelings'
take
sake.
A deep breath.
Even if you're appalled.
Take off your blindfolds.
Oh my god!
Remember, this was the room with the silver spray-painted bamboo as the focal point.
This is so cool.
And none of us on the set really liked it all that much to begin with. And we're certain, even secretly, that the homeowner doesn't either. And then it happens. She starts to cry. Real, can't fake these tears. Overwhelming euphoria because of a redone basement. Even some of the crew watching on the monitors, instructed not to utter a word, is getting a bit choked up. This is genuine jubilation. Well, the first time around, anyway.
Denis Grignon is a writer and broadcaster just outside of Toronto. Still ahead, boys with toys and the allure of a power drill.
Oh.
These are the Real Life Chronicles. I'm Tod Maffin. This morning, we are exploring the phenomenon of these home decorating and home improvement shows. And I have to admit, after our interview with Vivian Campbell was over, I grilled her on the best way to get on the show, like details. What words should I use in the letter? Last year, those two guys on the show, the designer guys, came to our studio to do an interview with Bill Richardson, and the building was abuzz with activity. These people would make a killing if they set it up as a service you could buy on the net. Punch in your address, and next week two designers and a carpenter will show up. And I know I'm not the only one.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Johnson, and I've been watching the Decorating Challenge for about, several years. I guess 4 years coming up now.
Hi, I'm Laurie Ann. I've been watching every single decorating show on the face of the earth for many, many years.
Jennifer and Laurie Ann are big fans of the Decorating Challenge, but they have a greater insight into the show than most. The West Vancouver Neighbors filmed an episode of the show last year, and now they've got their own stories to tell. Stories about how things really work when the cameras stop rolling. They spoke with our contributing producer, Don Brett.
Like, we redid Jennifer's dining room table. My husband was filmed on camera as if he'd done the whole thing himself. He touched it for maybe 30 seconds. So he's getting on camera, he gets the whole thing like, wow, he's really talented. He did the whole thing himself. The funny part, too, was they made our husbands do little artsy, crafty things.
Yeah.
Okay, when you watch the show on February 6th, neither one of our husbands do that.
Yeah, none of that.
My husband's like dreading, oh, God, they made me look so awful. Because, you know, at one point they put a boa around his neck and, oh, yeah. But, you know, he said, oh, it's fun. Yeah. What the heck? Yeah. And they went with it.
Yeah.
How did you guys get along with the designers?
Our designer, it was her first show. She was one of the local designers that was chosen. So she didn't do the design for TV. She did the design for the client because that's what her history was. So when she did the first scene where they open up all the paint cans and showed us all the fabrics, my expression was, oh, that's the ugliest thing I've ever seen. And she died 1,000 deaths because that's the first scene they shoot. And her face just died because before that, she was like, oh, my God, I can't wait to work with you guys. Now it's like, right on camera, these people are ditching me. Here, I got this big TV show I'm going to do, and they're ditching my first show. But as we knew from our past history is that they love controversy on TV.
Yeah.
And they made us do the same take 10 times. And each time they'd cut it, and then they put the paint cans back, and they'd say, okay, can you just hate it a little bit more? Can you look at the camera with just a little bit more disgust on your face? So by the 10th shot, I'm like puking in the paint can, and the designer is like freaking out. So after the 10th shot, my husband and I just jumped her on camera and just started hugging and kissing her just so she'd lighten up a bit. So after that, it was just...
Yeah, but you should say what color the paints were.
Well... Jennifer has this gorgeous red carpet. She brings out orange paint. I'm like, what are you, nuts? You know, nobody puts orange paint with red carpet, you know, so anyway. But it turned out absolutely stunning.
Yeah,
it's absolutely
beautiful.
Gorgeous.
What was your reaction during the reveal?
Oh, the only thing I could say was, this is amazing. And I was, because one thing they say to you is you can't swear, which my husband did.
Did he? He goes,
holy shit, oh, look at the chandelier. And all I could say was, this is amazing, because I was in such shock that they want you to speak. And all I kept thinking was, I got to say something. But I couldn't because I was in such shock.
And in our reveal, they had threatened me with my life that if I jumped off the mark, because every other shot in the whole weekend was, okay, take two, take three, take five, right? Yeah. But the reveal shot, they get one shot at that. So you're put onto a mark, and you're not allowed to move off that mark. And we're doing a bedroom, because I expected to be, like, jumping up and down and throwing myself on the bed, you know, getting my husband making love right there or something like that, right? And they were like, Laurie-Ann, you got to stay. You don't move. You don't scream. And they're used to me screaming all weekend. And they're like, don't scream, because my sound guy's going to go off. And I did the reveal, and my face just dropped, and I went, oh, my God, I don't know if I like it.
We thought she'd love it because I loved it. And then we saw her face and went, oh, my God, she doesn't like it. And I was so upset.
Yeah. But I was tired. But B, my eyes focused on the two things I didn't like. And one is they made this stunning, beautiful headboard for my bed, like 8 feet by 12 feet. And then they tied 50 white ribbons onto the headboard. And so my first eyes went to that. I'm like, don't you guys know there's a man that sleeps with me, you know? And then I turned around and there's this 50 meters of white organza over my window going, it's a bloody wedding chapel. What is this? So my face, I can't wait to see the video.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's just going to be like, oh God, I did some acting at least.
She did some very good acting. Yeah. Very good acting. Yeah.
And all it needed was like a couple tweaks.
Yeah.
Like, you know, just take the ribbons off, put better, you know, more complimentary curtains on the window, and I tweaked the duvet cover. I put a new duvet cover on, and now people just fall off the floor when they walk in.
It is
beautiful. Just stunning.
So, do you have any advice for viewers that are considering giving it a go?
Oh, be open minded. If you hate your room, we had such a fantastic experience that I would definitely do it again. Except the only problem is you have to redo the rest of your house because your one room looks so nice. You just go, oh, the rest of my house looks like crap now.
Can you use that word on CBC?
Yeah.
Ty Pennington is one home show handyman who has no problem drawing an audience. As the studly carpenter on TV's Trading Spaces, his good looks have not gone unnoticed. Last year, People magazine named him one of America's most eligible bachelors. And now, women everywhere are swooning over his building skills and boyish charm. It's an open secret that my sister Samantha doesn't watch the decorating show Trading Spaces for design tips alone. Most days, she couldn't care less if the designers blacked out the windows and painted the walls with pig's blood, just so long as carpenter Ty Pennington was on the job.
Well, to start with, what's not to like? I mean, the guy is, he's young and he's fun and he's kind of funky and he builds cool things. In inclement weather and under horrific circumstances and with nasty designers and bad floor plans, he's a very attractive fellow. He looks sort of like a next generation surfer skateboard dude. He's the kind of guys I hung out with when I was 15, only now he's pushing 30 and he's just as cute with the boyish charm and good sense of humor, but with some very real work skills.
Do you know he's like 37 years old?
Shut up, is he really? Oh, see, I'm liking him better all the time. I had no idea.
Would you think he was that hot if he didn't build things?
No, I think he was just a goof.
What is it about men who can fix and build things that make them so damn sexy?
Well, you know, in my 20s, I think I was inclined to think that it was the product of their labor. I was impressed that they could produce something that was so interesting and functional or whatever the case may be. But now I've gotten into my 30s, I think it's got something to do with things more primal. I think it's got to do with building of nests as much as it has to do with building of poorly leveled end tables. Funnily enough, as much as you don't really want to admit it, but apparently I'm going to, there's a real fantasy thing to it. I mean, there's always, you know, it falls in line with the whole, you know, pool boy, gardener kind of a thing, but the idea of some well-muscled, well-heeled fellow in your backyard with no shirt on a hot summer day, building you something functional with his own two hands, just makes you want to put on a flowery lace dress and carry out a cold glass of lemonade. I mean, I'm not quite sure what that's all about.
Sexual role-playing aside, Samantha says her admiration of handymen is rooted in something far more sensitive than a cheesy scene from a Daniel Steele novel.
I have a great appreciation for men that like to build things, and particularly those that want to take the time to build things that you'd like them to build. I think it's a representation of feeling. It's like cooking somebody a good meal, or choosing a lovely piece of artwork, or writing a song. When you build things with your hands, it's an extension of who you are, and it represents a piece of you.
And if you just happen to be a celebrity carpenter with a six-pack named Ty, all the better.